more people here afterwards. We'll have to sing to him. It was my John's birthday yesterday, by the way. So lots of birthday boys. But let's all stand together. Let's just set our gaze on Jesus and worship him. Isn't it awesome? The privilege to come into his presence and honor the King. Oh, Lord, we love you. Thank you so much for your presence here. Come and saturate this whole place with your glory, Lord. I thank you for those this morning who even were seeing angels up here, Lord. We thank you for the angels, and we thank you for your presence. And Lord, we honor you in this house. We love you. We love to meet with you. Come, oh God, even as we rend our hearts in this worship time, come and rend the heavens. Come and change us and transform us, Lord. Do what you love to do. Come, Holy Spirit, breathe your life. Come and break out. Come and transform our lives. Bodies to be healed this morning, oh God. Souls to be saved. God, growing more and more in love with you. So have your way, Lord Jesus. Have your way. Come and take over. Breathe your life. Ho, ho. We honor you. We love you. Thank you, Jesus. Come, Holy Spirit. Father, be exalted. In Jesus' name, release that worship, we pray, oh God, we pray.
Well, we have lots of space at the front, so I want to encourage you, come, find a space. We're feeling excitable this morning, so we're going to give him some praise. give him a big smile today. And I want you to ask them if there's anything to be thankful for this morning. What do we think, guys? Are we a thankful people this morning? Yeah? Oh God, we're thankful this morning. We're thankful this morning for all you've done, who you are. God, we just let go of our stresses, our worries, our cares this morning. Come on, let's lift our hands to him this morning. God, we lift it all up. We lift it all up. We come freely, freely this morning. We come to give you worship. Because you're good, and we say you're good. We declare this morning, you are good. You are good. What do you think is with me? I cannot keep it in. I'm so in love with you. I'm gonna sing and shout with all of my might. I cannot keep it in. I'm so in love with you. I'm gonna sing and shout with all of my might. Yeah. I cannot keep it in. I'm so in love with you. I'm gonna sing and shout with all of my might. Yeah. Thank you. Yes, you do. You make it. You make beautiful things. You make beautiful things out of us. We declare this morning that you make beautiful things. You make beautiful things out of us. You this morning to just come and go, come refresh our minds. I feel some of you just been living under this, like, this real burden of just feeling, you know, I'm a sinner, I'm a stuck sinner. But there's freedom for us. There's such freedom in Him. Makes all things new. He's a good, 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 good Father. So let's receive Him this morning. Let's receive Him. Receive the work that He's done this morning. Yeah. Receive the work He's done.
There is freedom for you this morning. There is freedom for us this morning. For the old has passed away, and the new has come to stay. Heart.
parts of your head. I'm starting to know that. Thank you.
shall reign over all creation. Forever you everlasting. Your kingdom knows no end. No one celebrates that you're coming back again. We sing in your throne. Your throne is everlasting. Knows no end. No one celebrates that you're coming back again. And the kingdom of this world, and the kingdom of this world has become the kingdom of our God. Come.
human judge. We exalt you in this place. We exalt you. We lift you high. You are Lord. We declare you are Lord of this church. You are Lord. Jesus is Lord of Toronto. Jesus is Lord of Canada. Jesus is Lord of this entire planet. We exalt you. We worship you. You know, just had some prophetic words about the release of joy. And you know, there's a release of joy as we recognize how his authority and his rule and his reign, that we win. Isn't that awesome? We win. Have you read the end of the book? Have you read the end of the book? He's coming to rule and reign. The kingdoms of our Lord, of this earth, have become the kingdoms of our Lord. You shall reign. Jesus, we exalt you. You know, I just felt like we need to just fill the front for a moment. If you need more joy in your life, can you just come forward for it right now? I just feel like God wants to release on Thursday night in the house of prayer. We haven't had a set like that for about a year and a half. For about a year and a half, we have not had a set that high, that high of a level of worship and joy. And Jonathan here was prophesying to me on Thursday, and he kept saying about there's going to be a release of joy, and it's joy, and God's releasing more joy. And I know that in the early days of revival, you know, there's such a release of joy. But anybody feel like we could use more right now? Come on, I agree. And you know, there's joy in the house of the Lord. And there's joy as we realize that He rules and He reigns and He is supreme. He's the winner and we're on His side. Is anybody on the Lord's side? Yes, Lord. So Father, right now in this place of worship, I thank you, God, that you're releasing joy. You're releasing joy in your church and in your body. You're releasing joy as we worship. You're releasing joy as we discover who we are in you. And I'm asking right now for a turning of the corner where there's this season of onslaught, but there's a turning of the corner in the name of Jesus. We declare the victory in the name of Jesus because He rules and He reigns. I'm asking this morning, Lord, release joy. Release joy. Release joy in the house of the Lord. Release joy as we worship. Release joy because the joy of the Lord is our strength. The joy of the Lord is our strength. One more song. Let's just dance. Let's worship Him. Release the joy.
Shaking out, as Taylor Swift would say, shake it off, shake it off. Maybe let's do a little bit of that, huh? A little bit of shake it off. Come on, we can all do this. That's gonna show us the action. Nice, very good. And maybe try and move your hips with that, yeah? Here we go. I don't think we've done this in a while, but this church had something very unusual happen in it. If you're newer to the church, you might not know the story, but Holy Spirit showed up in a way that wasn't expected, and it wasn't, it was hoped for, but the way that he did it wasn't expected, right? And you guys have heard about people getting drunk in the Spirit. It's offensive to the mind. I'm not going to lie, it's offensive to the mind. There have been times when I've been deeply disturbed in my mind about what is going on. And yet, every time we're more in love with him, every time we just love his presence more, we love Jesus more, we're more keen to go and tell people about him, right? It's good. And it's biblical, it happened. They said at Pentecost, like, why are you guys drunk? It's 12. Not even 12. Well, we're not even 12 yet. So when you put a hand on a person next to you, now, we're not looking for manifestations, yeah? We're not looking for any of that. If they happen, they happen, and that's cool. But what we're really looking for is for him to fill us, and you will feel in different ways, because everyone's different. So I don't want you to be pressured into feeling anything, but know that when we're praying for each other, the Holy Spirit is filling us. Some of you are going to feel a deep peace right now. Some of you are going to feel hope where there was no hope. Some of you are going to feel joy. Some of you are just going to feel like you've had a few too many beers. And that's okay. So let's just welcome him. I want you just all to say, thank you, Holy Spirit, and we welcome you. He's already here, but he loves us welcoming him into what we're doing. So thank you, Holy Spirit, we welcome you. Just keep praying over your friend.
More, Lord. More of you. More, Lord, more joy, more of the fruit of the Spirit, God, more of the fruit of the Spirit, more love, more joy, more peace, more patience, more kindness, more faithfulness, gentleness, self-control, more of you, just keep praying, more of you, more of the Spirit, more joy, the joy of the Lord is your strength, the joy of the Lord is your strength, the joy of the Lord is your strength, more of you, God.
Just keep going for it a bit. Keep going for it. This is the bit where we're not just singing about him. We're like encountering him. It's the best. Come on. We receive you today. We receive you today. He's breaking off the fear of yesterday. Breaking off the fear of yesterday. He's breaking off the pain of yesterday. He's bringing his peace, and he's bringing his joy, and he's bringing his love. Yes, you are. Yes, you are. Keep receiving it. Thank you, Holy Spirit. If you
you're not with someone, praying with someone, I just encourage you, go find someone and get with them. Oh, we bless you, Holy Spirit.
You know, just, I'm actually seeing a picture of the Lord just walking into the room, Jesus walking into the room. Oh, Lord, we ask for that increase of your presence. Can we just say how much we want him? Jesus, come. Jesus, come. Jesus, come. Would you walk into the room? Jesus, come. We want you. Jesus, come.
Yeah, we want you.
Jesus, come. Would you walk into the room? Jesus, come. Jesus, come. Jesus, come. Would you walk into the room? Jesus, come. Jesus, come. Jesus, come. Would you walk into this room? Jesus, come. Transform us. Jesus, come. Change us. Jesus, come. Would you walk into the room? Jesus, come. Jesus, come. Jesus, come. Would you walk into the room?
I just keep getting the words over and over. My love is fluid. My love is fluid. Just let it wash over you. Let it surround you like a warm bath. Let him comfort you. Let him wash you clean. This isn't about you trying to clean yourself or figure it out. This is him just washing over you. Water refreshes you, it feeds you, and it's fluid, it never stops. Just soak in that warm presence right now.
I just see the Lord just cutting off disappointments of each one of us. Why don't you just give it to him? All those unfulfilled promises, the things that you thought were going to come and happen one way and just didn't. So in Jesus' name, we just let go of our disappointments. Thank you, Jesus, for cutting off all disappointment, all sadness. And we just release the joy of the Lord that is such a weapon that will give you strength. His joy will give you strength. So as we let go of the disappointments, just embrace that joy. Say, Lord, I just welcome your joy. I welcome your joy. I'll let your joy arise and be my strength to push away everything that stands on the way. All disappointments, all the shortcomings. And we just bless you with his joy today to be that strength that we need to go forward. In Jesus' name.
Joy is such an awesome thing because it's in the atmosphere of heaven. It's around the throne of God. And Jesus taught us to pray on earth as it is in heaven. You know, there's something about joy that it doesn't depend on what happens. Happiness depends on what happens. But joy is an everlasting reality. It's in heavenly places. It lasts eternally. And it's here to manifest in this place. You know, that Nehemiah verse about the joy of the Lord is your strength. That word strength is actually, it's like it means refuge or fortification. It's a place of refuge. It's a place of protection that keeps you covered from any attack or anything that the enemy would try to throw your way. Which means that the things that happen do not penetrate the wall of joy that surrounds you, because it is a fortification. It's like the walls of the glory of God come and surround you. The joy enlarges your territory, enlarges your tent, that everlasting joy shall be upon your head. And so, Father, I pray in agreement to everything that's just been declared, everything you've done, Father, let us be aware of that everlasting joy. Lord, that does that dictates the final word as to what happens in our lives. It's the joy that has the final word. It's the joy that does not yield and bow its knee to the circumstances of what happens, but it stands strong and steadfast. And so fill our hearts with joy and let our faces declare it as well in Jesus' name.
Let's just give him a shout. Come on. Jesus! Woo! You are worthy. We love you. Can we say a big happy birthday to Jonathan Clark, turning 27 today? Jonathan, John Bootsma, birthday yesterday. Happy birthday to the Johns and Jonathans.
I figured we couldn't get John Clark to sing happy birthday to himself up there with his guitar, but anyway, we can all sing it. To you, happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear John. Happy birthday to you. And I don't know if there's anybody else out there that has a birthday today. Hands up, anybody else, November 9th? Happy birthday to you over there. Why don't you stand up? Anybody else, November 9th? All right, good. That's awesome.
Vero, can you make your way to the stage, Vero? And Gordon Hickson, come on up here.
And just as you're making your way back, a few things we want you to be aware of. We're going to roll the video announcements in a bit. But we've got those shoe boxes back there, and I think a lot of you think that those shoe boxes are full. We actually had our children make them so that you wouldn't have to put them together into boxes. They made them ready there. And so please take them, because the deadline, I believe, is the 19th of November to return the shoe boxes, to give it to kids all around the globe. And so if you haven't picked up a shoe box yet, you know, wouldn't it be great if at least one per person, and just go and fill it and be a blessing, be a giver to those. So pick up those shoe boxes, please.
I just wanted my friend here, Gordon Hickson, to say hi. He's actually from Oxford. Come on up here, Gord. He just happens to be in town. Anybody heard of Rachel Hickson? Because Rachel Hickson is his wife, a real strong prophetic voice, yeah, who often tries. He says he's normally known as Rachel's husband, but he has his own identity. He's a very amazing pastor, amazing leader. So, yeah, Patricia's husband.
Just saying, good to meet you. I'm Patricia's husband.
Gordon, just say hi from Oxford. And
yeah, it's so good to be back here. For me, it's quite emotional because I came here exactly 20 years ago. I came to a conference in that October, end of October in 94, and God really did something deep in our lives. But I've just been here with the Canadian Network of Ministry to Muslims, and I now run a ministry called Mahabba. And as I looked at your, Mahabba means love, and as I looked at your back wall, I just see that we may walk in God's Mahabba love. Say it with me, Mahabba. Mahabba is love in Arabic and Urdu and Farsi. But we're just witnessing the fear being broken off ordinary Christians and love just beginning to penetrate. It's not the specialists that lead Muslims to Christ. It's just simple, ordinary Christians that break out of the fear and love their Muslim neighbors. And God's trusted hundreds of thousands of Muslims into your hands here in Toronto. Wow. Hundreds of thousands. Wow. And I think it's time to reach them. Amen? Yeah. So God bless you from Oxford.
Wow. That's a good word. Gordon, can you come on down here? Let's have some of our leadership team pray for him. Joan, come on up here. Thank you for saying that, Gordon. We're targeting this area. This is Joan here. Gordon, meet Joan. Don't let him sit down, you guys. Come and blast him. Lillian, can you help? And whoever else. Jonas lives in the area of 90% Muslims to target them in salvation. So, Father, we just thank you for the salvation of the Muslim people, God. The veil would be lifted in the name of Jesus. And, Father, thank you for this man who's standing for righteousness, travels all over the world to this cause. And, Lord, let your glory come upon him in Jesus' name. Vero, awesome. Vero, if you remember, is our social justice. She leads this ministry here, and she's an amazing voice to remind us what's going on in Canada. Vero, talk to us.
Yeah, and I wore my Canada shirt, as you can see here, because this week, every time I look at the clock, it's 7:28. And that's Psalm 72, verse 8. He shall have dominion from sea to sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth. And I've just been declaring that this week, and I just thought as I come and tell you this good news this morning, that I would wear this my Canada shirt. So you would remember that in the spring I came up here and talked to you about the prostitution laws that were being challenged. And so basically the pro-prostitution lobby that wanted to have legalization of prostitution and say that prostitution is just a normal job and it's a choice, they challenged the laws and everything was struck down, and we had a year to rewrite the laws. The good news is that we won. Because every one of you that sent postcards, that signed the petitions, your voice was heard, and not only they rewrote the laws, and it's amazing, but it's better than what was struck down. So it's better than what we had before. Can we get an amen? God is amazing. So we went from being like, oh my goodness, prostitution is going to be legal, the pimp is going to be like a normal businessman, and to basically having not only the prostituted people being seen as victims, which they most often are, and they're going to be helped. There's robust funding from the government. They're going to be helped to get out of prostitution. yes. And for the first time in the history of Canada, the buying and advertising of sexual services will be illegal. It was not illegal before. It's an amazing law. So it passed the Senate just this week, got royal assent. So in 30 days, it's law and it will be applied. And it's just amazing. Praise God. Now, the interesting thing, the second thing I have to mention to you today, is that during the same week, something else came up that I want you guys to participate in and fight for, okay? Because we want Canada to be righteous and just. We want God's kingdom to reign in our nation, and we want to be healing to the nation. We want to be an example in every area. So many of you have seen in the news the new curriculum that they're trying to implement again at the sexual education in as early as grade one. So I'm not going to go into all the details because I'm sure that most of you have heard it because the media is all over it. But what we can do and what we have to do, we seriously have to do something. Because what they're trying to teach our children in our schools now in Ontario is age inappropriate, and it's really contentious to our values as Christian and as most Canadians, to tell you the truth. If you want to know the details, you can just search it on the internet, because I don't even want to mention what they want to tell our kids. Okay? So what you can do is, there's a lot of petitions online, and I'm going to post those on our social justice page on Facebook. There's a lot of petitions, but most of the petitions that are out there is to include an opt-out clause in the curriculum, because as it stands, they want to force the kids to learn what they want to teach them. So they want to make it so the parents cannot pull their kids out of those classes if they don't agree with them. And there's not going to be any warning as to when they're going to teach those things. And that's going to come as early as September 2015. Now, remember the good news I just told you, how far we came, right? So there's nothing impossible with God. So to me, the opt-out clause is not enough. I don't want this stuff to be taught at all to anybody. And I don't just care about my children. I care about all Canadian children and all the parents that are not aware of this. Okay, so what we can do is call our trustees, call the principal of our local schools, even if you don't have kids in school. Because when it comes down to implementing the curriculum, it depends on the school, it depends on the local trustee, and if they don't agree with it, they're not even going to teach it, okay? So if there's enough of us all over Ontario that say, this is not my values, I don't want this to be taught to my children, they're going to listen. They're going to have to listen, and prayer backing it all up will have an amazing effect, just like it is for the prostitution laws, okay? So this week, just get on the phone, call your trustees. It's not as hard as it seems, okay? And what you can say is just that you don't agree with this because it's age inappropriate, and the content that you don't agree with. Just, you know, try to not say that try to not sound too Christians, because they actually said that they're ready this time for the religious groups and they're not going to bow to them. So just try to be wise in the choice of your words, and let's win this one too, okay?
Amen. And one thing I heard too is that they're going to have 2,000 parents, have input into, it's like a survey or something. So parents, you can volunteer. You can volunteer to have input into this. And so we would love some Catch the Fire parents to volunteer. But Vero, could you be at the back afterwards to talk? Because I know there's petitions. There's one petition that's going around that already has 10,000 signatures. And I think that's another way that we can, you know, signing petitions saying that this is not okay. We do not want this in the school system. And can we could just pray. Can you lead us in prayer?
Sure. thank you, Lord, that there's nothing impossible for you. And thank you, God, that our voice are being heard when we speak out. And we just pray, God, that you would turn things around once again, God, that our nation, God, would be righteous and just, that it would reflect your values, God, and that our children would be protected, and not just our children, but the ones around us, our neighbors, God. We just pray that you would turn things around, God, that you would change the heart of the people who are trying to put this forward, God, and that you would stop it. God, I pray that you would give us a strategy, even as the church, that we would be able to turn things around in Jesus' name. The guy that actually wrote this curriculum was convicted of making child prostitution. So we don't want his values instilled in our children.
No,
amen,
we don't.
Amen and amen.
Thank you so much, Vero. Yes. Thank you too, Isaiah. Anyway, at this time we want to receive the morning's tithes and offerings. And as we do that, in light of just the theme of the Holy Spirit's releasing in joy, I just want to say God loves a cheerful giver. And whether you're giving, you know, like Veronique is, you know, giving to release the kingdom out there in the streets, whether you're giving of yourself to your neighbors, I think whatever the opportunity is, the Lord is just wanting to see that joy of the Lord released. And it is contagious, by the way. And so this morning, as we've prepared our tithes to return to the Lord, as we've prepared offerings to give into the kingdom of God, and as we, as the local church, even as one branch of the local church in the entire city, our heart is to see the kingdom of God advance in the city. Our heart is to see the name of Jesus high and lifted up. I want you to even make a declaration over your gifts this morning that there would be a supernatural grace that would enable that to be taking place. And I see some of you waving, you know, there's the wave offerings. It's like, declare, Lord, we believe that this is something holy unto the Lord, that we're giving it to you, and we're trusting that you multiply it wherever it goes, but you're also going to multiply it back into our hands in Jesus' name, because I believe he wants you to be blessed so that you can be a blessing. So thank you for being a cheerful giver. Any checks can be made payable to Catch the Fire this morning, please. Thank you for those of you in advance that have already signed up through our online giving, through regular, you know, that way whether you're here or not, you're faithful in that. And thank you as well to those that are online that are have chosen to give that way. We do appreciate it. And we just believe God for a mighty impact that the world is not going to be able to stand against in Jesus' name. So thank you for that. Go ahead and pass the plates, and may the Lord bless your giving this morning. A few other things to be made aware of. We do play the announcements on the screen before and after, so we always try to not put too much time into things here, but we do want you to know that we have a Christmas feast, also known as an annual Christmas meal that we do, and that'll be December 7th. You can sign up to bring a dish or volunteer on Connect, or if you need some help, we're going to have a table set up at the front. We also have a 55 and up. Yeah, and if you got a skit or a song that you want to be able to release at that time, we want it to be fun, and so release some of your gifting and talent. Come and talk to any of us here in the office, to Salome. Could you stand, Salome? Salome is our intern, one of them, and give it to Salome or myself or Patricia. Thank you. 55 and up, we got our Christmas luncheon December 7th. Penny Choli, where are you, Penny? Penny, if you can stand where you are. There's Penny, and she's going to be at the back as well, and so if you want to even buy a ticket, tickets are $7. If you can buy a ticket for a senior to bless them, I think that would be great. That way we're not asking our seniors to contribute to that, but we just want to be able to cover the cost as well on that. So buy a ticket for a senior, and then we'll give them to who's needed, or buy several tickets if you're able to want to make a donation for that. That'd be fabulous. And also, Atwell Coffee Music Night happening Monday, this Monday at 7 p.m. There's posters around that are going to do that. So can we roll the video announcements, please, Koki? Thank you.
Hey friends, Steve Long here. It's video announcements, and I've got some exciting news for you. Friday night, we had our very first warm-up meeting for Catch the Fire Barry. And Connie and Jeremy Sinnott are going to be the faces of our Barry campus. And so that is going to be having monthly warm-up meetings from now until who knows, and with a very, very tentative start in the spring of next year of Sunday meetings. And so we're really excited about that. If you've got friends, family in the Barry, Aurelia, that kind of area, let Connie and Jeremy know. Send me an email as well, and I can email. I can forward that on your behalf. Should be great. This coming Sunday is the last Sunday to get your Christmas boxes back to the airport campus or to your campus. And so if you can make sure you do that, and if you need some boxes, they are available. Just talk to your campus pastor. Thank you, everyone, for helping in that project. December 3 is our annual appreciation reception evening for all of you that serve in any ministry. And most of you are going to be getting an email via Connect with all the details for that. And if you don't get an email by next week, then just call up our office and say, I'm actually volunteering. I help out in our ministry. I don't think I was on any of the particular lists. And so just let us know if you'd like to be here. It's going to be a fun evening. It's a little bit of dress-up time, lots of food, great reports, and some prizes as well. So thank you, everybody who serves at any of our campuses in any ministry. That event is for you. Sandra and I are looking forward to some of the events that are coming up in the next couple weeks. We have an amazing prophetic weekend with Stacy Campbell and our own Patricia Bootsman. And Stacy Campbell, if you are not aware, is just one of the high-level prophetic voices in Canada and really around the world. And she was the one who prophesied that the Pope was going to become the Pope when he was a cardinal in Argentina. That was a number of years ago. And so that's the level she's at. She is the director or the leader of the Canadian Prophetic Council, and our own Patricia Bootsman is also on that team. So that's a very, very good thing. So that event's coming up. And for all of you who are young at heart and younger young adults, our annual Henry Wayne Conference starts January the 1st. It's going to be a great, great time. Just to let you know, we're going to have a New Year's Eve party, December 31st. Chris McLarney, who wrote the song Your Love Never Fails, is going to be with us. He's going to be leading like a 90-minute to a two-hour concert that night. Should be a great, great time. Also going to be having a Christmas Eve meeting at the airport campus, and I think a couple of the other campuses are going to be doing that, so we'll let you know as time comes up. That's all you need to know. Well, actually, there's lots you need to know. Things are on the screen right now.
Hi, my name is Tammy Fernando. I've been a part of Catch the Fire since 2005, and I grew up here through the youth ministry. A great way that Catch the Fire has transformed my life has been by teaching me about the Father's heart and about His love for me, and just a lot of healing that I've gone through over the years here at Catch the Fire. So, yeah.
Amen. Awesome. Well, how many of you have been the recipient of Restoring the Foundations ministry in some way, shape? Wow, look at all those hands, Chester and Betsy. Hold them high. That is fantastic. John and I as well, we went through the full one twice. And then we
some
also...
Some people have more needs than others.
Yeah, I know. And then lots of upkeep through the years. But phenomenal ministry that the Lord is just exploding all over the earth. We're so thrilled to have the founders. Let's stand. Let's honor this couple. Chester, Betsy, Kylstra, we love you. Hope this feels like home for you.
And bring this
come
couple, you can introduce a couple of friends with you as well.
So we're thrilled to have Betsy speaking this morning, but they're going to introduce their friends as well. So over to you.
Well, good morning. It's always good to be here. We always feel like we're coming home when we come to Toronto and Catch the Fire. So thank you for welcoming us and continuing the revival atmosphere and family spirit, okay? Because that's really nourishing to us when we come. So we had a good time Friday night. We talked on the two deadly patterns. If you've got them, why don't you go watch that and get rid of them? I'll leave it to you to find out what they are. What we mainly want to do this morning, besides Betsy bringing the message, is to introduce to you Lee and Cindy Whitman. Hello. They currently live in Nashville, Tennessee, but they'll be moving over to Hendersonville, North Carolina. About 4 years or so ago, God told us that these two were our successors. And so this February, we approached them and let them know that. And we're very proud of them. We're very pleased with God's choice. They're our choice. And we just wanted to introduce you to them. Do you want to say anything?
It is such an honor to be here, first of all. And secondly, it's just an amazing opportunity that God's given us to work with Chester and Betsy, and then to work with the body. I mean, just the number of people that raised their hands. The influence that RTF has had on people is amazing. And we're excited about taking that, and because the world needs healing. You agree with me? And so we want to work with your church, with people, to raise up more ministers, because there's more need than people can handle right now. So it's just an awesome opportunity that we're very excited about, and we look forward to the future of building relationship with you all, and just, that's Southern, by the way, y'all. But to build that relationship, we're looking forward to that.
You want to say anything? Okay. Good. Thank you.
Okay.
Good.
John and Patricia, I forgot to ask you, are we heading for 12:30? Do we have a right around 12:30? 12:30, 12:40. Good, okay. You know what it means when somebody who's preaching puts their watch down on the pulpit? Nothing. Thank you, worship team, this morning. That was so awesome. Just special. And yeah, isn't that good? And so I hope we're going to be all right, because I got a new impartation of joy. And I hope you got a fresh dose too. Praise the Lord. I'd also just like to recognize George and Lori Hall. They are our RTF directors in Canada. Would you guys stand? We're so proud of them. They're doing such a good job. Thank you. You know, we've been connected here for 20 years, and I feel like the Bootsmans are part of our extended family, and they really supported this ministry and us personally, and Steve and Sandra have been wonderful support. We were just with them in South Africa with Heidi Baker, one of her harvest schools, had a chance to teach and just renew our friendship with Steve and Sandra, and that was wonderful. Yeah, for whatever reason, and maybe you're prophetic enough to figure this out, I've been real attracted these last few years to old lady jokes. So I'm going to tell you the one I like the best, and then we'll get on with the message. So there's this old lady, it's just so full of God. She just loves the Lord, and every morning, she lives in this little duplex, and every morning she gets out and she says, "Glory to God, I just love you, Lord. Thank you for your provision. Hallelujah." And all that went around really well for a couple of years. And then this atheist moved next door. And the atheist liked to get on out on his little deck, too, in the early morning. So they had this kind of antiphonal thing going on where she was saying, "Glory to God, hallelujah." And he was saying, "There is no God, you're wasting your breath." So that didn't slow her down, you know, hallelujah. So she was just going, "Oh, glory, thank you, Lord, thank you." And he was going, "There is no God, there is no God, you're wasting your breath." So one morning she said, "Lord, thank you for all your provision, but Lord, you do know that I'm out of grocery money." And he said, "There is no God, and he's certainly not going to supply your groceries." So she got out faithfully the next morning, and she said, "Lord, thank you so much, and thank you for those two bags of groceries that were on my deck this morning." And he said, "There is no God, and I brought those groceries to you." And she said, "Hallelujah, Lord, thank you for your provision, and thank you for letting the devil pay for it." That'll bring you a little joy. Add to the joy quotient. One of my favorite psalms, Psalm 27, verse 13, says, I would have despaired if I had not seen the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Have you experienced some of His goodness recently? Did you think about your life? Can you think of some points of just saying, God is so good. God is so good. I want to talk to you this morning about living your dream. Living your dream. Chester and I are living our dream. We're walking on our dream. We're swimming in our dream. We're dancing in our dream. We're wallowing in our dream. We are doing the dream that God put into our hearts. And that's what He wants for you. He's no respecter of persons. He wants to see you doing your dream. After all, in John 10:10, when it says, the thief, the enemy came to steal, kill, and destroy, but I came that you might have life. And have it what? More abundantly. More abundantly. I love a translation that I read not too long ago that says, for that, I came that they might have and consistently retain a vitality, a gusto, vigor, and a zest for living that springs up from down deep inside, that they might embrace this richly loaded life, richly loaded life, unequal and matchless, incomparable, richly loaded, and overflowing to the ultimate maximum. Can you think of any more words? I think they got a good set of words to talk about the abundant life. So what I'd like to do is give you 12 principles or guidelines or characteristics of a dream. What makes up a dream? How do you characterize that? And then I'd like to tell you about a dream that started in my life when I was age 9 and came to pass last April when I was age 73. Though the vision tarry, wait for it. Though the vision tarry, wait for it. What characterizes a dream, number one, is it's given by the dream giver. It's not something we make up, is it? It's something that's imparted. It's something that comes in our spiritual DNA from the foundation of the world. It's planned in. It comes with you as a package. Secondly, it's birthed out of our identity in Him. We only get to know that dream as we get to know who He is. The dream comes out of that connection, out of that connectedness. The dream is released, this is 3, as we abide in Him. In Him, we live and move and have our being. We abide in Him, and as we do that, as He is in us and through us and around us, that dream comes into being. And part of that is that His Word begins to possess us. Have you ever been possessed by a word that God gave you? Either the Logos word or a Rhema word, and it's like you live out of that word. You dream that word. You think that word. That word feeds you. That word brings life to you. That's part of the dream. Your dream has eternal significance. Number 5, your dream looks impossible. Ha 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 ha. It is, and that's why it looks that way. But it's only when your small yes unites with God's divine yes, and the supernatural comes in and ignites and makes connections and provides the way and empowers the dream. And then it's not impossible. But your dream won't fly without the supernatural. The supernatural gives it wings. Your dream will be opposed by the enemy, but this is the unexpected part. Often it's the enemy working through the very people that you love. My mother and father were two of my greatest spiritual heroes. Just an incredible people of faith and stability and love, and all the way through to the end. And yet, when I call them to say, I really think we're called to go to Bible school and get trained, my mother's first response was, well, honey, you're entirely too old. Nobody will want you. That was 30 years ago. So sometimes the very people that you think are going to be the ones that stand by you just don't get it. They just don't get it. They didn't hear the same voice that you heard rising up inside. And they are thinking on one level while you're in the supernatural. And you're saying, God, why are these people coming against me? I don't understand it. Your dream will also be tested by God. And somewhere along the way, it will die and fall into the ground as a grain of wheat. I'll tell you briefly what happened to Chester and I. We were going along fairly early in the ministry, and we thought we were doing at least pretty well. And one Sunday morning, we were sitting up in bed praying together, holding hands, and we were just saying, God, show us the ministry as it is now. Now, to be really honest with you, I was expecting a nice pat on the back from the Lord. Daughter, you're doing good. Just hang in there. That's really what I was expecting. And what Chester and I both heard at the same time absolutely shocked us. This is what the Lord said. He said, the ministry as you know it today is dead, and don't you try to resurrect it. And we saw a casket laying out in front of us. We were confused. We were devastated. Lord, what are you doing? Is there some kind of sin in our life that we don't know anything about? Are we blind? Are we off track? Where have we missed it? And the next 6 months were some of the most miserable months of our entire lives together. In January of that year, my pastor, who was very prophetic, said, how are you doing? And I said, terrible. And she kind of smiled and went on, and I thought, well, help, you know, help, help, help. But that next Friday night, which was a school of the Holy Spirit, we were in the back of the auditorium, and she asked us to stand. This is what she said. She said, there have been things happening over the last 6 months that you don't understand. And you've cried out, and you've said, God, what is the matter? What are you doing? And you've been confused, and you've been upset. And the Lord said, do you think Abraham understood everything I asked him to do? Am I not the Lord that can provide the ram in the thicket? And I asked you to give up your Isaac. And surely the Lord says, you have laid down your Isaac, and you have passed the test. I don't think anybody else in that auditorium knew what that word meant to us. But we knew exactly what it meant. We knew God said it had died and not to raise it up. That we had laid our Isaac on the altar, and now he was raising it up. And we felt that newness of life and that validation from the Lord, that now we could move forward. And out in those next months, the network was born. Things began to grow and flourish. But we knew who was doing it. Unless a grain of wheat fall to the ground and die, it won't be raised up to multiply. So your dream will be tested, whatever it is, whether it's for raising a godly children, affecting your neighborhood, helping to make policies in the schools, helping to change a nation, going to the mission field, whatever it is, it will be tested. God will speak to you about your dream over and over. It's not a one-time deal. You're not going to miss it. You're going to hear it, and he's going to enlarge on it. He's going to expand it. He's going to fine-tune it. There may be seasons to it. But it's not just something you hear one time. So you must never fear, suppose I miss it. If you're listening, you're going to get it. You're going to get it. Then one day, there comes this incredible shift. You think, my dream, me and God, what we are doing. And then all of a sudden, you realize, this isn't about me. Somebody's laughing because they've been there. Many of us have been there. And this revelation that comes that this is about him. This is about the kingdom. This is about multi-generations. This is so much bigger than me and my part. And it's a shift that is divinely timed. And as we move into that, we get the big picture. We get the big picture. Where are you in your dream? I got to watch my parents fulfill their dream. I got to watch my uncle and my aunt fulfill a very different dream, a dream in business, which is very significant and impacted many. But you know something? God didn't call us here. He didn't call you here to watch somebody else fulfill their dream. He called you here for you to fulfill what he's placed in you. And that's what he desires today. That's what he desires. Oh, hallelujah. I want to say that whatever your past, we have a God of redemption. Don't we? Don't you know him that way? Yes, we have a God of redemption. You know, many of you friends here know my story. But my story was being born to a 17-year-old girl, illegitimately, was born in a Salvation Army shelter, given away for adoption, et cetera, and a lot of brokenness. But God comes into that picture. But God, would you say that over your own life? But God, he's the one that comes in and restores. He gave us the ministry we have first for us, for our own brokenness. The 11th thing, if you're taking notes, about the dream. It's never too late to start the dream. There is no expiration date on it. It's not like your canned soup that says it's going to expire next April. Your dream can start now. to be expressed. And it can go till your last breath. Hallelujah. It's not a temporal thing, though it has manifestations in the temporal. And the last thing is your dream is for this generation. It's for now. Other people may have done similar things in other generations, but God is empowering you for the now. For the now. God's updating the dream. He's fine-tuning the dream. He's tailor-made it for you, but he's made it to release now in this time in history, which he chose for you to be born. You know, the last thing we sang today was about the Creator ruling and reigning over all the earth. You know how that's going to happen? As you carry out your dream, as you do that thing that God has placed in your heart. That's one of the ways he's going to rule over all creation. Are you living your dream? Do you need God to download a dream to you? Have you started your dream, but somehow there have been so many obstacles that you couldn't pursue it, that you've given up, or maybe you've had an illness along the way and gotten slowed down, or maybe finances hadn't come in? I want to tell you today, don't give up on your dream. Ask the Lord to reignite it in you so that you can move forward and be part of a vital, vital time in history. When I was 9 years old, I had the privilege of my grandmother coming to live with us. I was in a small little town in North Carolina, and my grandfather had died that year. My grandmother, who had been a pastor's wife for years and years and a Bible teacher, she came to live in our home. And the other really cool thing that happened was her sister came to live in that same little town. And her sister had been a missionary doctor to China for 50 years. Her whole life was China. And every day I sat there as this little 9-year-old and I listened to these two amazing women talk about the things of God. And as my grandmother's sister talked about the Chinese Christians, the price they paid, the spiritual warriors that they were, the vision that they had, what they were willing to risk for the gospel, something got ignited deep, deep inside of me. And this is what it was. Lord, someday I want to have something to offer to the Chinese Christians that will bring strength and help to them. Well, I grew up, made a lot of mistakes in my life, and I thought the dream was dead. Then in Bible school, we went to a Bible school that had a great mission organization, and every year we would have this wonderful mission conference. And you know, I had this fire engine red suit at that time. So I would sit on the second row so God could see me. Here I am, God, in my red suit. I'm ready to go to China. I'm willing. All you've got to do is just give me the word. Hallelujah. This is good. But he never did. The end of each mission conference, I would just be so let down, so disappointed. God, what's the matter? But that wasn't to be the call. And so that dream stayed on the back burner for some more years. About 10 years ago, I started to say a young businessman, but everybody's young to us now. A businessman from California came and went through the ministry, and we were talking to him, and he asked me, he said, "Betsy, what's your dream?" And before I could even think what I wanted to say, I said, "The Christians in China." And I just began to weep. It wouldn't stop. I couldn't control it. I didn't want to be weeping right then. But it was still so deep. It hadn't gone away. And he said, well, I've spent a lot of years in China, and the first thing I want to do is help you get your book put into Mandarin Chinese. And so we did that. And so then into our, well, a little bit before that, God had said to Chester one day in a worship service, your greatest influence of your ministry is going to be in Asia. Well, at that point, we didn't have much of a ministry, and we didn't know a single Asian. So your dream might feel that way, too. Like, well, how impossible? But we got the materials translated. Several years ago, a couple came to us that had spent their last 15 years of their lives overseeing the education of the leaders of 8 networks in the Chinese underground church. They fell in love with RTF and said, we got to bring this. Long story short, so last April we go. It's a room of about 50 people because there are 3 or 4 leaders from each of these large, large networks. You know, I was looking for a Chinese face. I wanted a Chinese face that I could remember when I got home. Couldn't take a lot of pictures, but I wanted a face. I didn't care if it was a man or a woman. I just wanted something that that face would represent those people to me and my contact with those people. And so I was really looking for faces. And I want to tell you in our remaining time about the faces. The first 2 that I noticed were sitting over to my right. And I'd have to call them the frozen couple because they looked down the entire time that we were speaking. They didn't look at each other. They didn't look at the people on the next seats. They didn't look up. People prayed. They just looked down. And their faces never changed expression. And then there was a woman at the back of the room, and she had dark eyes and very dark hair, and she would pace. And she would go back and forth and back and forth. Well, that didn't bother me. I was, you know, when I was teaching, well, what it did bother was the woman that had a new baby, because when she would go and back and forth, the baby would wake up. And so here we were with the baby waking up and crying. Lady, but as I looked at her face, I said, what is that expression? I know that I know it. And as I looked at her, I realized that expression was terror. It was fear and panic and terror. And I said, oh God, what has happened in this woman's life? And then at the very back of the room was Big Mike. Big Mike was just huge. He must have been 6'6 or 7. And Big Mike had freckles. Big Mike could have been wearing a sign that says, I've never been loved, I've always been abandoned. And it was just right across his forehead. And every time I looked at him, I saw that yearning and that rejection. And so Big Mike's face stood out to me at the very back of the room. And then there was a man in the pink shirt. And I noticed him for 2 reasons. One is that he wore the pink shirt every day. And the second was that he was a really good-looking man. And you know, it's okay for us older women to notice. It's just all right if we appreciate. And that man had a look on his face that said, I'm not sure about all this, but I've come to find out if this is really God. And then there were the uncles. There were these 3 men that when they walked, they were kind of aloof. They were probably in their 50s. They held together. They didn't connect too much with other people. But their combined time in prison was longer than my lifetime. They'd paid the price. And it was written in the deep wells of faith. that you just felt in their presence. So here were my faces. We began to teach on Tuesday, and we taught Tuesday and Wednesday, and those faces stayed the same. The frozen couple didn't thaw out. Big Mike just looked ever so yearning and hungry for love. The frightened woman continued to pace back and forth. Wow. And the uncles crossed their arms and looked at me like this, and I thought, this is not a good prophetic sign. Don't know what's happening here. And then on Thursday morning, we came to demonstrate healing. And we were demonstrating with a man who was our host. He was the 11th of 12 children. And when he had been about 10 years old, his family had sent him from Malaysia to Singapore, where he was to stay with a family he didn't know. His own family was so rejecting of him that he just felt like, I don't think anybody even said goodbye to him. And the Lord came in the tangible presence of the Lord and came into that room that day to minister to him. And the atmosphere shifted. You can feel it sometimes, can't you? You just know. And the Lord began to minister his love. And the Lord began to tell him about his value and his destiny. The Lord began to heal his heart. Now, this man was sitting with his back to the audience, and we were facing the audience. So I decided to cheat. So this is how I cheated. I had my hands over my face, but what I did was I spread out my fingers so I could see them and see what was happening. And what I saw for the first time was with the frozen couple, there was a tear running down the man's cheeks. What I saw with Big Mike was that his face was lifted up with a look of peace on his face for the first time. What I saw with the woman who was pacing was that she had curled up, and for the first time, her face began to look content and not tense and fearful. And I looked at the uncles, and they were bent over, and their heads were in their hands, and they were deep in prayer. And I looked at the man in the pink shirt, and his head was down, but just nodding, "Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord." God came in and changed the atmosphere. He's so good at that when he comes. It's why we love his presence so much. And so we went into deliverance. And these people are powerful spiritual warriors. The thing that my grandmother's sister had told me about years ago, I witnessed, this time with the tears running down my face. And so we got to the end of the seminar, and our host said to us, "You know, these people are leaders over millions, and they are very reticent to share anything personal in front of each other." And we could understand that. They said, "Do you want us to have a testimony time?" And we said, "Why don't we have one and make it really general and broad and just say, okay, anything you got this week that you feel like would help somebody in your network or just was good for you, just come up and share it." We thought that was pretty non-threatening. And they told us, "Be prepared if nothing happens." I said, "It's okay, let's just give an invitation." So we had hardly got the words out of our mouth. Then the man of the frozen couple ran to the front and grabbed the microphone. You could have knocked me over. He said this, For the last year, I've wanted to kill myself. And he said, I have been in the most pain because I just couldn't find God in everything that was going on around me. And he said, I've been so mean to my leaders. I've been so hard to live with. And then he asked his wife to come forward. And in front of all of the leaders, he simply said, would you forgive me? Our host couple threw their arms around these two that had been so frozen. And something again broke in that room. And as they shared a little of their testimony and went back to their seats, people reached out to touch them and provide comfort for them. And there was an atmosphere of we all care about each one. And then the woman who had been pacing came to the front. And this is what she said. She said, when I was in prison, I was beaten so harshly and so much that I can't sit down without pain. Oh, yeah. And she said, I live with the terror of the police and being in prison again. And she said, during the time of healing, Jesus came to me as I saw myself being beaten and I saw myself in prison. And I don't know how this happened, but he took all of the pain and the fear out of me. And she just began to dance. Hallelujah. Nobody ever seen her like that. And people were weeping who had never wept in front of each other. And the face that we, the public face, was coming down. And then Big Mike got up. And Big Mike looked different. And he came up slowly from the back of the room, and I thought, what is he going to say? And he said this. He said, you know, I've spent so much time trying to get people to love me. But what just happened during the healing was that Jesus came to me, and he said, I love you with an everlasting love, and I'll never leave you. And he said, that love poured into my heart. And he said, I'm okay. He said a Chinese version of that. It's being translated for us. And then he said something that was so humbling for me. He said, you know, my mother never hugged me. Betsy, I wonder if you would come up here and just hug me. And so I went, and I stood on my tiptoes the best I could to hug Big Mike. And I just prayed, Jesus, let these be your arms. Oh, let these be your arms that hold this precious man. And let your heart again just reach him. And then there was a hush in the room. You know, that kind of, you can hear a pin drop. And I realized that one of the uncles, one of the three uncles themselves had gotten up. And it's almost like people stopped breathing, waiting to hear what he was going to say. And this is what he said. He said, my earliest memory is of my mother and father screaming at each other, my father threatening my mother, and me trying to stand in the middle to separate them and stop the violence. And he said, I've always carried a guilt because as a little boy, I wasn't able to stop it. But he said, Jesus came and took that. And he said, most of the people that I know need this kind of healing. Would you come back? (Laughs) It was all because we didn't give up on the dream. Our dream is not any more important than your dream. Our dream may have been there longer, but we knew, though the vision tarry, wait for it. We knew it was part of what God had. We didn't know how it would happen. Since we have been here on Friday night, somebody emailed that they wanted to help finance more training in China. Hallelujah. But what I want to ask you today is, where are you with your dream? God wants you to have it. He wants to reignite it. If it's grown dull, if you've been discouraged, the prophetic word about letting go of the discouragement was so perfect, because today God wants to reignite what He's placed in you, to breathe His breath on it afresh, to touch it, to touch the impossible with the possible, to touch the natural with the supernatural. And He's here to do that today. Now, the first group of people, there are two groups I want to call down here and ask the prayer teams to pray for you. But there's another group that just you feel like, I just don't have a dream. I would like to ask you to humbly stand, and I want to pray for you. If there's anybody here that just feels like, I don't have a dream. Anybody here? Okay. It'd be okay. I see a person standing, and I'd like to pray. Lord, you're the dream giver. It's not our good intentions. It's not something our parents wanted us to do. It's what you've put in our heart. And I ask you today to download to my brothers and my sisters that which you have for them that's greater than them. Lord, I bind all the fear and the unworthiness that would try to say, I can't do this. I don't see how it would happen. I take authority over those beliefs today. And I release these people to receive and receive and receive everything that you have. And then, Lord, I ask you to bring into place the supernatural things of finances and people and open doors as you prepare and train them as they begin to receive and act on the dream. Lord, release fresh hope to each one here. In Jesus' name, you can be seated. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And then I would like to ask, if you've had a dream, and I want to ask the prayer ministers to come forward, but if you've had a dream, but it really has tarried, you've been discouraged with it. You felt like, I got started on it, but I hadn't seen the fullness of it. Then I'd like you to come to this side of the church to receive prayer and have somebody come into agreement with you that your dream, the fullness of it, is going to come. And then if you're a person and you feel like your dream has just been totally blocked and you're ready to give up, I want you to come to this side. Over to this side. If your dream has just been blocked and you feel like, I just don't know. I just don't know. I just don't know how God could ever do that in me. And so, Lord, thank you for the anointing and the agreement of these who are going to be praying. We release a fresh anointing onto the prayer ministers. We release your blessing. We release fresh hope and fresh vision out over this place that your vision is coming. Your kingdom is coming through every man and woman here. In the mighty, mighty name of Jesus, amen.
We could just have the worship team come back up. And if you do not know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, I just want to encourage you to come and speak to myself, John, here at the front. We would love to introduce you, our Savior. But let's worship a little bit here. Jonathan had to shift to the youth ministry, but Alice is going to lead us in worship. Lord, we just ask that you come, go deep. Deep calls to deep. It's not even so much about who prays for you as it is about you just encountering Jesus. And there's something about what she said about times where the dream feels dead as well. And I just bless resurrection, that there's a resurrection. It feels like Resurrection Sunday. So come, Holy Spirit, just break in. Power of the Spirit, break in by the power of the Spirit. We love you. We sit our gaze upon you.
Presence.